Heaven. Heaven, or the heavens, is a common religious, cosmological, or transcendent place where beings such as gods, angels, spirits, saints, or venerated ancestors are said to originate, be enthroned, or live. According to the beliefs of some religions, heavenly beings can descend to earth or incarnate, and earthly beings can ascend to heaven in the afterlife, or in exceptional cases enter heaven alive. Heaven is often described as a higher place, the holiest place, a paradise, in contrast to hell or the underworld or the low places, and universally or conditionally accessible by earthly beings according to various standards of divinity, goodness, piety, faith, or other virtues or right beliefs or simply the will of God. Some believe in the possibility of a heaven on earth in a world to come. Another belief is in an axis mundi or world tree which connects the heavens, the terrestrial world, and the underworld. In Indian religions, heaven is considered as Svargaloka, and the soul is again subjected to rebirth in different living forms according to its karma. This cycle can be broken after a soul achieves moksha or nirvana. Any place of existence, either of humans, souls or deities, outside the tangible world heaven, hell, or other, is referred to as otherworld. The modern English word heaven is derived from the earlier, Middle English, heaven, attested 1159. This in turn was developed from the previous Old English form heaphone. By about 1000, heaphone was being used in reference to the Christianized place where God dwells, but originally, it had signified sky, firmament, for example in Beowulf, circa 725. The English term has cognates in the other Germanic languages, Old Saxon heben sky, heaven, hence also Middle Low German heaven sky, Old Icelandic himin, Gothic himins, and those with a variant final L, Old Frisian himmel, himmel sky, heaven, Old Saxon and Old High German himmel, Old Saxon and Middle Low German himmel, Old Dutch and Dutch himmel, and Modern German himmel. All of these have been derived from a reconstructed Proto-Germanic form himina, or hemo. The further derivation of this form is uncertain. A connection to Proto-Indo-European chem cover, shroud, via reconstructed Kaman or Kaoman stone, heaven, has been proposed. Others endorse the derivation from a Proto-Indo-European root H2 ekmo stone and, possibly, heavenly vault at the origin of this word, which then would have as cognates ancient Greek kappa mu omega nu, akmon anvil, pestle, meteorite, Persian, asamon, azimuth stone, slingstone, sky, heaven, and Sanskrit, azimuth stone, rock, slingstone, thunderbolt, the firmament. In the latter case English hammer would be another cognate to the word. The ancient Mesopotamians regarded the sky as a series of domes, usually three, but sometimes seven, covering the flat earth. Each dome was made of a different kind of precious stone. The lowest dome of heaven was made of jasper and was the home of the stars. The middle dome of heaven was made of sagalmit stone and was the abode of the Agigi. The highest and outermost dome of heaven was made of luludanatu stone and was personified as in, the god of the sky. The celestial bodies were equated with specific deities as well. The planet Venus was believed to be Inanna, the goddess of love, sex, and war. The sun was her brother Utu, the god of justice, and the moon was their father Nanna. In ancient Near Eastern cultures in general and in Mesopotamia in particular, humans had little to no access to the divine realm. Heaven and earth were separated by their very nature. Humans could see and be affected by elements of the lower heaven, such as stars and storms, but ordinary mortals could not go to heaven because it was the abode of the gods alone. In the Epic of Gilgamesh, Gilgamesh says to Enkidu, "Who can go up to heaven, my friend? Only the gods dwell with Shamash forever." Instead, after a person died, his or her soul went to Kur, later known as Irkala, a dark shadowy underworld, located deep below the surface of the earth. All souls went to the same afterlife, and a person's actions during life had no impact on how he would be treated in the world to come. Nonetheless, funerary evidence indicates that some people believe that Inanna had the power to bestow special favors upon her devotees in the afterlife. Despite the separation between heaven and earth, humans sought access to the gods through oracles and omens. The gods were believed to live in heaven, but also in their temples, which were seen as the channels of communication between earth and heaven, which allowed mortal access to the gods. The Igur temple in Nippur was known as the Durinki, the mooring rope of heaven and earth. It was widely thought to have been built and established at Enlil himself. Almost nothing is known of Bronze Age, pre-1200 BC, Canaanite views of heaven, and the archaeological findings at Ugarit, destroyed circa 1200 BC, have not provided information. The 1st century Greek author Philo of Byblos may preserve elements of Iron Age Phoenician religion in his Sankaniathon. The ancient Hittites believed that some deities lived in heaven, while others lived in remote places on earth, such as mountains, where humans had little access. In the Middle Hittite myths, heaven is the abode of the gods. In the Song of Kumarbi, Allalu was king in heaven for 9 years before giving birth to his son, Anu. Anu was himself overthrown by his son, Kumarbi. As in ancient Near Eastern cultures, in the Hebrew Bible, the universe is commonly divided into two realms, heaven, Samaim, and earth, Eres. Sometimes a third realm is added, either sea, water under the earth, or sometimes a vague land of the dead that is never described in depth. The structure of heaven itself is never fully described in the Hebrew Bible, but the fact that the Hebrew word Samaim is plural has been interpreted by scholars as an indication that the ancient Israelites envisioned the heavens as having multiple layers, much like the ancient Mesopotamians. This reading is also supported by the use of the phrase heaven of heavens in verses such as, and. In line with the typical view of most Near Eastern cultures, the Hebrew Bible depicts heaven as a place that is inaccessible to humans. Although some prophets are occasionally granted temporary visionary access to heaven, such as in, and, they hear only God's deliberations concerning earth and learn nothing of what heaven is like. There is almost no mention in the Hebrew Bible of heaven as a possible afterlife destination for human beings, who are instead described as resting in Sheol. The only two possible exceptions to this are Enoch, who is described in as having been taken by God, and the prophet Elijah, who is described in as having ascended to heaven in a chariot of fire. According to Michael B. Hundley, the text in both of these instances is ambiguous regarding the significance of the actions being described, and in neither of these cases does the text explain what happened to the subject afterwards. The God of the Israelites is described as ruling both heaven and earth. Other passages, such as, state that even the vastness of heaven cannot contain God's majesty. A number of passages throughout the Hebrew Bible indicate that heaven and earth will one day come to an end, and. This view is paralleled in other ancient Near Eastern cultures, which also regarded heaven and earth as vulnerable and subject to dissolution. However, the Hebrew Bible differs from other ancient Near Eastern cultures in that it portrays the God of Israel as independent of creation and unthreatened by its potential destruction. Because most of the Hebrew Bible concerns the God of Israel's relationship with his people, most of the events described in it take place on earth, not in heaven. The Deuteronomistic source, Deuteronomistic history, and priestly source all portray the temple in Jerusalem as the sole channel of communication between earth and heaven. During the period of the Second Temple, 515 BC to 70 AD, the Jewish people lived under the rule of first the Persian Achaemenid Empire, then the Greek kingdoms of the Diadochi, and finally the Roman Empire. Their culture was profoundly influenced by those of the peoples who ruled them. Consequently, their views on existence after death were profoundly shaped by the ideas of the Persians, Greeks, and Romans. The idea of the immortality of the soul is derived from Greek philosophy, and the idea of the resurrection of the dead is derived from Persian cosmology. By the early 1st century AD, these two seemingly incompatible ideas were often conflated by Jewish thinkers. The Jews also inherited from the Persians, Greeks, and Romans the idea that the human soul originates in the divine realm and seeks to return there. The idea that a human soul belongs in heaven and that the earth is merely a temporary abode in which the soul is tested to prove its worthiness became increasingly popular during the Hellenistic period, 323 to 31 BC. Gradually, some Jews began to adopt the idea of heaven as the eternal home of the righteous dead. Descriptions of heaven in the New Testament are more fully developed than those in the Old Testament, but are still generally vague. As in the Old Testament, in the New Testament, God is described as the ruler of heaven and earth, but his power over the earth is challenged by Satan. Sayings of Jesus recorded in the Gospels of Mark and Luke speak of the kingdom of God, while the Gospel of Matthew more commonly uses the term kingdom of heaven. Both phrases have exactly the same meaning, but the author of the Gospel of Matthew changed the name kingdom of God to kingdom of heaven in most instances because it was the more acceptable phrase in his own cultural and religious context in the late 1st century. Modern scholars agree that the kingdom of God was an essential part of the teachings of the historical Jesus. In spite of this, none of the Gospels ever record Jesus as having explained exactly what the phrase kingdom of God means. The most likely explanation for this apparent omission is that the kingdom of God was a commonly understood concept that required no explanation. Jews in Judea during the early 1st century believed that God reigns eternally in heaven, but many also believed that God would eventually establish his kingdom on earth as well. This belief is referenced in the first petition of the Lord's Prayer, taught by Jesus to his disciples and recorded in both and, "Your kingdom come, your will be done, on earth as it is in heaven." Because God's kingdom was believed to be superior to any human kingdom, this meant that God would necessarily drive out the Romans, who ruled Judea, and establish his own direct rule over the Jewish people. In the teachings of the historical Jesus, people are expected to prepare for the coming of the kingdom of God by living moral lives. Jesus's commands for his followers to adopt lifestyles of moral perfectionism are found in many passages throughout Synoptic Gospels, particularly in the Sermon on the Mount. Jesus also taught that, in the kingdom of heaven, there would be a reversal of roles in which the last will be first and the first will be last, and this teaching recurs throughout the recorded teachings of Jesus, including in the admonition to be like a child in, and the parable of the rich man and Lazarus in, the parable of the workers in the vineyard in, the parable of the great banquet in, and the parable of the prodigal son in. Traditionally, Christianity has taught that heaven is the location of the throne of God as well as the holy angels, although this is in varying degrees considered metaphorical. In traditional Christianity, it is considered a state or condition of existence, rather than a particular place somewhere in the cosmos, of the supreme fulfillment of theosis and the beatific vision of the Godhead. In most forms of Christianity, heaven is also understood as the abode for the redeemed dead and the afterlife, usually a temporary stage before the resurrection of the dead and the saints' return to the new earth. The resurrected Jesus is said to have ascended to heaven where he now sits at the right hand of God and will return to earth in the second coming. Various people have been said to have entered heaven while still alive, including Enoch, Elijah and Jesus himself, after his resurrection. According to Roman Catholic teaching, Mary, mother of Jesus, is also said to have been assumed into heaven and is titled the Queen of Heaven. In the 2nd century AD, Irenaeus of Lyons recorded a belief that, in accordance with those who in the afterlife see the Savior are in different mansions, some dwelling in the heavens, others in paradise and others in the city. While the word used in all these writings, in particular the New Testament Greek word omicron rho alpha nu sigma, ouranos, applies primarily to the sky, it is also used metaphorically of the dwelling place of God and the blessed. Similarly, though the English word heaven still keeps its original physical meaning when used, for instance, in allusions to the stars as lights shining through from heaven, and in phrases such as heavenly body to mean an astronomical object, the heaven or happiness that Christianity looks forward to is, according to Pope John Paul II, neither an abstraction nor a physical place in the clouds, but a living, personal relationship with the Holy Trinity. It is our meeting with the Father which takes place in the risen Christ through the communion of the Holy Spirit. While the concept of heaven, Malkuth Hashemim, the kingdom of heaven, is much discussed within the Christian and Islamic religions, the Jewish concept of the afterlife, sometimes known as Olam Haba, the world to come, is not discussed so often. The Torah has little to say on the subject of survival after death, but by the time of the rabbis two ideas had made inroads among the Jews. One, which is probably derived from Greek thought, is that of the immortal soul which returns to its creator after death. The other, which is thought to be of Persian origin, is that of resurrection of the dead. Jewish writings refer to a new earth as the abode of mankind following the resurrection of the dead. Originally, the two ideas of immortality and resurrection were a different, but in rabbinic thought they are combined. The soul departs from the body at death but is returned to it at the resurrection. This idea is linked to another rabbinic teaching, that men's good and bad actions are rewarded and punished not in this life but after death, whether immediately or at the subsequent resurrection. Around 1 CE, the Pharisees are said to have maintained belief in resurrection, but the Sadducees are said to have denied it. Matthew 22:23. The Mishnah has many sayings about the world to come. For example, Rabbi Yaakov said, "This world is like a lobby before the world to come. Prepare yourself in the lobby so that you may enter the banquet hall." Judaism holds that the righteous of all nations have a share in the world to come. According to Nicholas DeLange, Judaism offers no clear teaching about the destiny which lies in wait for the individual after death, and its attitude to life after death has been expressed as follows: for the future is inscrutable, and the accepted sources of knowledge, whether experience, or reason, or revelation, offer no clear guidance about what is to come. The only certainty is that each man must die, beyond that we can only guess. According to Tracy R. Rich of the website Judaism 101, Judaism, unlike other world religions, is not focused on the quest of getting into heaven but on life and how to live it. In order from lowest to highest, the seven heavens, Shema, according to the Talmud, are listed alongside the angels who govern them. The Quran contains many references to an afterlife in Eden for those who do good deeds. Regarding the concept of heaven, Jannah, in the Quran, verse 35 of Surah Al-Rizq says, "The parable of the garden which the righteous are promised. Beneath it flow rivers. Perpetual is the fruits thereof and the shade therein. Such is the end of the righteous, and the end of the unbelievers is the fire." Islam rejects the concept of original sin, and Muslims believe that all human beings are born pure. Children automatically go to heaven when they die, regardless of the religion of their parents. The concept of heaven in Islam differs in many respects to the concept in Judaism and Christianity. Heaven is described primarily in physical terms as a place where every wish is immediately fulfilled when asked. Islamic texts describe immortal life in heaven as happy, without negative emotions. Those who dwell in heaven are said to wear costly apparel, partake in exquisite banquets, and recline on couches inlaid with gold or precious stones. Inhabitants will rejoice in the company of their parents, spouses, and children. In Islam, if one's good deeds outweigh one's sins, then one may gain in transcendent heaven. Conversely, if one's sins outweigh their good deeds, they are sent to hell. The more good deeds one has performed, the higher the level of heaven one is directed to. It has been said that the lowest level of heaven, the first one, is already over 100 times better than the greatest life on earth. Houses are built by angels for the occupants using solid gold. Verses which describe heaven include: Islamic texts refer to several levels of heaven: Firdaus or Paradise, Adn, Eden, Jannah Jahannam, Heaven of Delight, Mawa, Refuge, Darussalam, Home of Peace, Darul Maqama, Home of Permanence, Al Muqamul Amin, The Secure Place, and Jannat al Khuld, Heaven of Immortality. According to the Ahmadiyya view, much of the imagery presented in the Quran regarding heaven, but also hell, is in fact metaphorical. They propound the verse which describes, according to them, how the life to come after death is very different from the life here on earth. The Quran says, according to Mirza Ghulam Ahmad, the founder of Ahmadiyya sect in Islam, the soul will give birth to another rarer entity and will resemble the life on this earth in the sense that this entity will bear a similar relationship to the soul, as the soul bears relationship with the human existence on earth. On earth, if a person leads a righteous life and submits to the will of God, his or her tastes become attuned to enjoying spiritual pleasures as opposed to carnal desires. With this, an embryonic soul begins to take shape. Different tastes are said to be born, which a person given to carnal passions finds no enjoyment. For example, sacrifice of one's own rights over that of others becomes enjoyable, or that forgiveness becomes second nature. In such a state, a person finds contentment and peace at heart, and at this stage, according to Ahmadiyya beliefs, it can be said that a soul within the soul has begun to take shape. The Baha'i faith regards the conventional description of heaven and hell as a specific place as symbolic. The Baha'i writings describe heaven as a spiritual condition where closeness to God is defined as heaven. Conversely, hell is seen as a state of remoteness from God. Baha'u'llah, the founder of the Baha'i faith, has stated that the nature of the life of the soul in the afterlife is beyond comprehension in the physical plane, but has stated that the soul will retain its consciousness and individuality and remember its physical life. The soul will be able to recognize other souls and communicate with them. For Baha'is, entry into the next life has the potential to bring great joy. Baha'u'llah likened death to the process of birth. He explains, the world beyond is as different from this world is different from that of the child while still in the womb of its mother. The analogy to the womb in many ways summarizes the Baha'i view of earthly existence. Just as the womb constitutes an important place for a person's initial physical development, the physical world provides for the development of the individual soul. Accordingly, Baha'is view life as a preparatory stage, where one can develop and perfect those qualities which will be needed in the next life. The key to spiritual progress is to follow the path outlined by the current manifestation of God, which Baha'is believe is currently Baha'u'llah. Baha'u'llah wrote, "Know thou, of a truth, that if the soul of man hath walked in the ways of God, it will, assuredly return and be gathered to the glory of the Beloved." The Baha'i teachings state that there exists a hierarchy of souls in the afterlife, where the merits of each soul determines their place in the hierarchy, and that souls lower in the hierarchy cannot completely understand the station of those above. Each soul can continue to progress in the afterlife, but the soul's development is not entirely dependent on its own conscious efforts, the nature of which we are not aware, but also augmented by the grace of God, the prayers of others, and good deeds performed by others on earth in the name of that person. In the native Chinese Confucian traditions, heaven, Jian, is an important concept, where the ancestors reside and from which emperors drew their mandatado rule in their dynastic propaganda, for example. Heaven is a key concept in Chinese mythology, philosophies and religions, and is on one end of the spectrum a synonym of Shangdi, supreme deity, on the other naturalistic end, a synonym for nature and the sky. The Chinese term for heaven, Jian, derives from the name of the supreme deity of Zhou dynasty. After their conquest of the Shang dynasty in 1122 BC, the Zhou people considered their supreme deity Tian to be identical with the Shang supreme deity Shangdi. The Zhou people attributed heaven with anthropomorphic attributes, evidenced in the etymology of the Chinese character for heaven or sky, which originally depicted a person with a large cranium. Heaven is said to see, hear and watch over all men. Heaven is affected by man's doings, and having personality, is happy and angry with them. Heaven blesses those who please it and sends calamities upon those who offend it. Heaven was also believed to transcend all other spirits and gods, with Confucius asserting, he who offends against heaven has none to whom he can pray. Other philosophers born around the time of Confucius such as Mozi took an even more theistic view of heaven, believing that heaven is the divine ruler, just as the son of heaven, the king of Zhou, is the earthly ruler. Mozi believed that spirits and minor gods exist, but their function is merely to carry out the will of heaven, watching for evildoers and punishing them. Thus they function as angels of heaven and do not detract from its monotheistic government of the world. With such a high monotheism, it is not surprising that Mohism championed a concept called universal love, Jainai, which taught that heaven loves all people equally and that each person should similarly love all human beings without distinguishing between his own relatives and those of others. In Mozi's Will of Heaven, he writes, Mozi criticized the Confucians of his own time for not following the teachings of Confucius. By the time of the later Han dynasty, however, under the influence of Xunzi, the Chinese concept of heaven and Confucianism itself had become mostly naturalistic, though some Confucians argued that heaven was where ancestors reside. Worship of heaven in China continued with the erection of shrines, the last and greatest being the Temple of Heaven in Beijing, and the offering of prayers. The ruler of China in every Chinese dynasty would perform annual sacrificial rituals to heaven, usually by slaughtering two healthy bulls as a sacrifice. In Buddhism there are several heavens, all of which are still part of samsara, illusionary reality. Those who accumulate good karma may be reborn in one of them. However, their stay in heaven is not eternal, eventually they will use up their good karma and will undergo rebirth into another realm, as a human, animal or other being. Because heaven is temporary and part of samsara, Buddhists focus more on escaping the cycle of rebirth and reaching enlightenment, nirvana. Nirvana is not a heaven but a mental state. According to Buddhist cosmology, the universe is impermanent and beings transmigrate through a number of existential planes in which this human world is only one realm or path. These are traditionally envisioned as a vertical continuum with the heavens existing above the human realm, and the realms of the animals, hungry ghosts and hell beings existing beneath it. According to Jan Chosen Bays in her book, Jizo, Guardian of Children, Travelers, and Other Voyagers, the realm of the Asura is a later refinement of the heavenly realm and was inserted between the human realm and the heavens. One important Buddhist heaven is the Trayastrimsa, which resembles Olympus of Greek mythology. In the Mahayana worldview, there are also pure lands which lie outside this continuum and are created by the Buddhas upon attaining enlightenment. Rebirth in the pure land of Amitabha is seen as an assurance of Buddhahood, for once reborn there, beings do not fall back into cyclical existence unless they choose to do so to save other beings, the goal of Buddhism being the attainment of enlightenment and freeing oneself and others from the birth-death cycle. The Tibetan word bardo means literally intermediate state. In Sanskrit the concept has the name Antarabhava. Brahmaloka. Here the denizens are Brahmas, and the ruler is Mahabrahma. After developing the four Brahma-viharas, King Makadeva rebirths here after death. The monk Tisa and Brahmana Janus and I were also reborn here. For a monk, the next best thing to nirvana is to be reborn in this Brahmaloka. The lifespan of a Brahmas is not stated but is not eternal. Parinirmita Vashavartin or Parinimita Vasavati. The heaven of devas with power over, others, creations. These devas do not create pleasing forms that they desire for themselves, but their desires are fulfilled by the acts of other devas who wish for their favor. The ruler of this world is called Vashavartin, Pali, Vasavati, who has longer life, greater beauty, more power and happiness and more delightful sense objects than the other devas of his world. This world is also the home of the Devaputra being of divine race, called Mara, who endeavors to keep all beings of the Kamadhatu in the grip of sensual pleasures. Mara is also sometimes called Vashavartin, but in general these two dwellers in this world are kept distinct. The beings of this world are tall and live for 9,216,000,000 years, Sarvastivada tradition. Nimanarati. The world of Devas delighting in their creations. The Devas of this world are capable of making any appearance to please themselves. The lord of this world is called Sunirmita, Pali Sunirmita. His wife is the rebirth of Visakha, formerly the chief Upasika, female lay devotee, of the Buddha. The beings of this world are tall and live for 2,304,000,000 years, Sarvastivada tradition. The world of the joyful Devas. This world is best known for being the world in which a bodhisattva lives before being reborn in the world of humans. Until a few thousand years ago, the bodhisattva of this world was Svetaketu, Pali, Setakitu, who was reborn as Siddhartha, who would become the Buddha Shakyamuni. Since then the bodhisattva has been Natha, or Nathadeva, who will be reborn as Ajita and will become the Buddha Maitreya, Pali Maitreya. While this bodhisattva is the foremost of the dwellers in, the ruler of this world is another Deva called, Pali, Santusita. The beings of this world are tall and live for 576,000,000 years, Sarvastivada tradition. Anadapindika, a Kosalan householder and benefactor to the Buddhist order, was reborn here. Yama. The denizens here have a lifespan of 144,000,000 years. Tavatimsa. The ruler of this heaven is Indra or Chakra, and the realm is also called Trayatramiya. Each denizen addresses other denizens as the title Marissa. The governing hall of this heaven is called Sudhama Hall. This heaven has a garden in Nandanavana with damsels, as its most magnificent sight. Ajita the Lakavi army general was reborn here. Gopika the Sakyan girl was reborn as a male god in this realm. Any Buddhist reborn in this realm can outshine any of the previously dwelling denizens because of the extra merit acquired for following the Buddha's teachings. The denizens here have a lifespan of 36,000,000 years. Kadam Maharajika. The heaven of the four great kings. Its rulers are the four great kings of the name, and their leader. The Devas who guide the sun and moon are also considered part of this world, as are the retinues of the four kings, composed of dwarfs, Gandharvas, fairies, nagas, snakes, and goblins. The beings of this world are tall and live for 9,000,000 years, Sarvastivada tradition, or 90,000 years, Vibhayavada tradition. There are five major types of heavens. Attaining heaven is not the final pursuit in Hinduism, as heaven itself is ephemeral and related to physical body. Only being tied by the bhut-tattvas, heaven cannot be perfect either and is just another name for pleasurable and mundane material life. According to Hindu cosmology, above the earthly plane, are other planes, 1, Bhuvalaka, 2, Swargloka, meaning good kingdom, is the general name for heaven in Hinduism, a heavenly paradise of pleasure, where most of the Hindu devatas, Deva, reside along with the king of Devas, Indra, and beatified mortals. Some other planes are Maharloka, Janaloka, Tapaloka, and Satyaloka. Since heavenly abodes are also tied to the cycle of birth and death, any dweller of heaven or hell will again be recycled to a different plane and in a different form per the karma and maya, i.e. the illusion of samsara. This cycle is broken only by self-realization by the jivatma. This self-realization is moksha, Turiya, Kaivalya. The concept of moksha is unique to Hinduism and is unparalleled. Moksha stands for liberation from the cycle of birth and death and final communion with Brahman. With moksha, a liberated soul attains the stature and oneness with Brahman or Paramatma. Different schools such as Vedanta, Mimamsa, Sankhya, Nyaya, Vaishika, and Yoga offer subtle differences in the concept of Brahman, obvious universe, its genesis and regular destruction, Jivatma, nature, Prakriti, and also the right way in attaining perfect bliss or moksha. In the Vaishnava traditions, the highest heaven is Vaikuntha, which exists above the six heavenly lokas and outside of the Mahatattva or mundane world. It's where eternally liberated souls who have attained moksha reside in eternal sublime beauty with Lakshmi and Narayana, a manifestation of Vishnu. In the Nasadiya Sukta, the heaven/sky Vayaman is mentioned as a place from which an overseeing entity surveys what has been created. However, the Nasadiya Sukta questions the omniscience of this overseer. The shape of the universe as described in Jainism is shown alongside. Unlike the current convention of using north direction as the top of map, this uses south as the top. The shape is similar to a part of human form standing upright. The Devaloka, heavens, are at the symbolic chest, where all souls enjoying the positive karmic effects reside. The heavenly beings are referred to as devas, masculine form, and devas, feminine form. According to Jainism, there is not one heavenly abode, but several layers to reward appropriately the souls of varying degree of karmic merits. Similarly, beneath the waste are the narkaloka, hell. Human, animal, insect, plant and microscopic life forms reside in the middle. The pure souls, who reached siddha status, reside at the very south end, top, of the universe. They are referred to in Tamil literature as, Kerala 43. As per Sikh thought, heaven and hell are not places for living hereafter, they are part of spiritual topography of man and do not exist otherwise. They refer to good and evil stages of life respectively and can be lived now and here during our earthly existence. For example, Bhagavad Kabir rejects the otherworldly heaven in Guru Granth Sahib and says that one can experience heaven on this earth by doing company of holy people. The Nahua people such as the Aztecs, Chichimecs and the Toltecs believed that the heavens were constructed and separated into 13 levels. Each level had from one to many lords living in and ruling these heavens. Most important of these heavens was Omeokan, place of two. The 13 heavens were ruled by Ometeot, the dual lord, creator of the dual genesis who, as male, takes the name Ometekutli, two lord, and as female is named Omisiwatl, two lady. In the creation myths of Polynesian mythology are found various concepts of the heavens and the underworld. These differ from one island to another. What they share is the view of the universe as an egg or coconut that is divided between the world of humans, earth, the upper world of heavenly gods, and the underworld. Each of these is subdivided in a manner reminiscent of Dante's Divine Comedy, but the number of divisions and their names differs from one Polynesian culture to another. In Maori mythology, the heavens are divided into a number of realms. Different tribes number the heaven differently, with as few as two and as many as 14 levels. One of the more common versions divides heaven thus. The Maori believe these heavens are supported by pillars. Other Polynesian peoples see them being supported by gods, as in Hawaii. In one Tahitian legend, heaven is supported by an octopus. The Polynesian conception of the universe and its division is nicely illustrated by a famous drawing made by a Ta'omotuan chief in 1869. Here, the nine heavens are further divided into left and right, and each stage is associated with a stage in the evolution of the earth that is portrayed below. The lowest division represents a period when the heavens hung low over the earth, which was inhabited by animals that were not known to the islanders. In the third division is shown the first murder, the first burials, and the first canoes, built by Rata. In the fourth division, the first coconut tree and other significant plants are born. It is believed in Theosophy of Helena Blavatsky that each religion, including Theosophy, has its own individual heaven in various regions of the upper astral plane that fits the description of the heaven that is given in each religion, which a soul that has been good in their previous life on earth will go to. The area of the upper astral plane of earth and the upper atmosphere where the various heavens are located is called Summerland. Theosophists believe hell is located in the lower astral plane of earth, which extends downward from the surface of the earth down to its center. However, Theosophists believe that the soul is recalled back to earth after an average of about 1,400 years by the lords of karma to incarnate again. The final heaven that souls go to billions of years in the future after they finish their cycle of incarnations is called Devachan. Anarchist Emma Goldman expressed this view when she wrote, "Consciously or unconsciously, most theists see in gods and devils, heaven and hell, reward and punishment, a whip to lash the people into obedience, meekness and contentment." Many people consider George Orwell's use of Sugar Candy Mountain in his novel Animal Farm to be a literary expression of this view. In the book, the animals were told that after their miserable lives were over they would go to a place in which it was Sunday 7 days a week, clover was in season all the year round, and lump sugar and linseed cake grew on the hedges. Some have argued that a belief in a reward after death is poor motivation for moral behavior while alive. Sam Harris wrote, "It is rather more noble to help people purely out of concern for their suffering than it is to help them because you think the creator of the universe wants you to do it, or will reward you for doing it, or will punish you for not doing it." The problem with this linkage between religion and morality is that it gives people bad reasons to help other human beings when good reasons are available. In Inside the Neolithic Mind, Lewis Williams and Pierce argue that a tiered structure of heaven, along with similarly structured circles of hell, is neurally perceived by members of many cultures around the world and through history. The reports are so similar across time and space that Lewis Williams and Pierce argue for a neuroscientific explanation, Accepting the percepts as real neural activations and subjective percepts during particular altered states of consciousness. Many people who come close to death and have near-death experiences report meeting relatives or entering the light in another worldly dimension, which share similarities with the religious concept of heaven. Even though there are also reports of distressing experiences and negative life reviews, which share some similarities with the concept of hell, the positive experiences of meeting or entering the light is reported as an immensely intense feeling state of love, peace and joy beyond human comprehension. Together with this intensely positive feeling state, people who have near-death experiences also report that consciousness or a heightened state of awareness seems as if it is at the heart of experiencing a taste of heaven. Works of fiction have included numerous different conceptions of heaven and hell. The two most famous descriptions of heaven are given in Dante Alighieri's Paradiso, of the Divine Comedy, and John Milton's Paradise Lost. Thanks for watching. Don't forget like the video and don't forget to subscribe.